Let's open with a prayer. O nameless and eternal one, elevate us fully out of the mind of this world, out of the workaday consciousness. Let us enter the stillness of presence, that we may be so transfused with spirit and with light, that we may see and hear and know the way before us. Guide us in all things and open us to that guidance, that we might respond in pure and loving obedience. Amen. Okay, so I've been working with some people, and trying to collectively come to a better approach to how we respond to current events. No matter what people's political bend is, these are really serious, trying times for people. People are struggling to find their balance and their equilibrium, and to respond in a proper way. Proper meaning that it's in keeping with their spiritual ideals and what they understand. That their spiritual life to be, and not to allow themselves to be sidetracked or carried away by the tsunami of things that are happening, and so one of the things that I asked these people to do was to come up with a list then of the things that they stood for, rather than what are you against, what are you for, what do you hold dear, what are your ideals, you know? And so I went through this exercise myself, and it was an interesting kind of metamorphosis that took place as I was doing it. So it started out with things like, I stand for kindness, compassion, caring, empathy, dignity for all living things. I stand for peace, inclusiveness, community, equal access, harmlessness. These are some of the things that just were coming to mind. And I'd be contemplating those things and working with them. And then it started to take a shift in my meditations about this. And the next thing that came to mind was, God is light and in him is no darkness at all. Okay, I stand for that. Okay, it's a little different than these other things, but all of a sudden there's something else happening. It is the Father's good pleasure to give us the kingdom. The spiritual body is perfect and is the framework for the physical. Synchronization happens. It is how evolution happens. We are synchronized, body, mind, and soul, to the highest vibration of light. Okay. So in a previous class, we talked about our function as the spiritual body of Earth. We have a spiritual body. It nourishes our physical body. It is the mediator between the self and soul and the physical. It is a body of light, and without it, the physical body could not exist. It would just disintegrate, right? And that when we respond to a calling to follow the way, whatever that is, however that looks in our particular spiritual journey, and we step out on that, and we're actually doing that, and we find that our entire structure begins to synchronize then with the teaching that is implicit in the way, with the power and reality and consciousness that is implicit in the way. Okay? So, and that as we do that, we begin to act like, take on the attributes of a spiritual body for the planet. Okay. And so let's look at it another way. If you have an ideal in mind, you will move towards that ideal, an ideal way of being, an ideal way of living, an ideal, whatever those ideals that we have, if they're there and held in mind, our lives conform to that, and we will move towards that. Okay. As we follow the way, we become that vision holder for the planet, for those around us, for ourselves even, you know, so that everything in and around us then will move towards that higher vibration. This is that synchronization. You know, synchronization is a marvelous thing to study, how that happens. But without that that high vibrational ideal out there, emanating consciousness and light, there's nothing to grow into. Okay. We grow into patterns that already exist. The fullness of the tree, the entire oak tree, is contained in the seed. And so there is that we take on, that we aspire to ourselves, and in our following that inspiration and that aspiration, we become that transmitting tower, that placeholder or vision holder for others. So that's what the ideal is. But the struggle that people are having is that they feel that they can connect with it in their meditation life, but when they start to engage with the quote real world, and particularly with the forces that have been unleashed around the world, not just in this country, but around the world, that are under the moniker, they fall under the moniker of populism for some reason, that there's this this idea that might makes right, that it's everyone for themselves, that I can step on your shoulders and on your head and grind your face into the dirt to reach a little bit higher myself to grab the thing that I'm looking for, you know. And there's this kind of permission that's being given to people to act in their less than noble ways, okay? And it's really hard for them, for people to integrate that energy and that vibe and that consciousness into their spiritual life and still be able to maintain that that position as a vision holder. Okay. So there are two things that I looked up in the Bible. I wrote them down that came to mind. One talks about how we're made in the image and likeness of God, right? And that we have dominion over the earth. Okay. And that's Genesis 1:26. And God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." Right. First, I love the fact that he says, "Let us make God, let us make man in our image." You know, okay, who's the R? But and our likeness. But it's this idea about having dominion and our the world that we see, the world that we have now. Is the world that we have collectively created, right? Over all the millennia of our existence. And I'm not talking about humanity's existence, but on our own existence, the cycles of reincarnation and our participation in the process of having dominion and being a co-creator with this being we call God. Taking that responsibility then, looking at it and owning it. Okay. And in light of what it is then that we're putting out, what we emote, the energy that we put into our actions, or in most cases our reactions to things that are going on around us, we have to get in touch with the fact that these aren't just happening in isolated moments inside our cranium. It's happening in the world at large. Every thought that we have and every emotion that we put out there impacts and molds and forms and reforms the world that we live in. And so there's this responsibility that comes with that. We know that it starts with, can we take care of our own lives? You know, we practice positive thinking and certain things that we can do to make course corrections in our own lives. When we see that, oh, you know, my thinking, I've been aware of my thinking. I've been aware of these thought patterns. And these thought patterns, these looping, you know, repeating tapes are not helping. I've got to change that. And so we change those and we see how effective that is, and that we've got this control that we didn't know we had. We thought we were just being battered around by whatever was happening around us and we were victims. But that starts to dissipate as we take on the reality of being co-creators and having dominion. Okay. But then we run across the need for being catapulted into a level of function, a level of consciousness and function that is so remarkable and indelible that we are never the same again. And from that moment on, we become this transmitting tower that synchronizes everything around it to itself, to the light that pours through it. Without equivocation, right? It's just like the strongest magnet on the block, you know? So John, the same John that St. John of the four Gospels, whose Gospel stands out as unique amongst the four, also wrote these epistles, or is believed to have written these epistles, these letters to people that he was working with later on in the early days of what became Christianity. And just to refresh our memories, what he said in the very first chapter of St. John, of the Gospel, in those first five verses: in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. So here we have this vibration, this word, the flesh of which is light, and the light is the very essence of life, and that there isn't anything in all of creation, there's nothing created that isn't made of that substance, right? That's all that exists. Not light and a smidgen of this and a pinch of that. It's just light. That's the only building block that there is. Same guy then writes that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and our hands have handled, of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. This, then, is the message which we have heard of him, and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie, and we do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. Okay. Sometime we'll talk about sin and all that business. Suffice it to say, it's not. It ain't your father's Buick. Okay. Okay, what I hear here is somebody who has had such a profound level of realization about the nature of self and being, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. This we declare unto you. Not, we think that this could be true, this is a good philosophy to live by, wouldn't it be nice if? No! This we declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. That's the reason that we do what we do. That's why we're here with the initiations. That's why we exist right now, is to embody the initiations and to make them accessible and available to a broadening circle of people. For each one that takes on that light becomes a transmission tower. And that transmission tower will demand that everything around it becomes synchronized to that light. Whether we talk about it or not, whether anybody knows anything about us or about any of this that we're doing or talking about or not, it does not matter. And so the temptation is always, and I hear this all the time, well, we live in a dualistic world, and wherever there's dark or light, there has to be dark, right? If there's good, there has to be evil. There's balance in the universe, and I go hogwash. I don't buy it. In him was light, and there's no darkness at all. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. This isn't light and dark. Now, there is a reality to the world of duality. Without it, there would be no time, right? Duality and time go hand in hand. There would be no space, no dimensionality, no here and there, up and down. There's no before and after. Those are dualistic things that need to be in place. That is, by the way, what the story of Adam and Eve in the garden is about, right? Picking the fruit of the tree, eating of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, of that duality. And from that moment on, we become immersed in form. Okay. That story is not a historical account of the way that we were created or something. It has to do with what you experience as a soul incarnating. Okay. The Garden of Eden is in you. That has never left. It's not a place, it's in you. Okay, so if we can convince ourselves to ignore all evidence to the contrary and hold fast to the realization that God is light and in him is no darkness at all, if we can put blinders on and just use that as our continual mantra over and over again, that no matter what is going on around us, no matter what ridiculousness is being promulgated on whatever level, we can just keep coming back to that same thing. That is the blessing and the benefit that we can provide to the world, right? To current events, to long time historical unfolding, whatever it is, that's it. Without having that, we're just all part of this floundering around, groping, bumping into things, barking our shins on the coffee table in the middle of the night. You know, it's and once again, and I have to keep saying this over and over again, because it's a slippery thing that slips right through our fingers when we talk about this. This does not mean that we don't engage with the world. This doesn't mean that we don't respond to the needs around us. It means that we don't react to them and that we don't believe in them. Now, you know, there is pain and suffering. You know, the Buddha said life is suffering, right? I get that. There's an experience of that that you can, that is obviously true for people. Our job is to find ways to ameliorate that suffering. However, that's what that, without believing in it. See, that's the thing, right? So that's the minute that we feel there's sympathy, which is akin to empathy, and then there's pity. The moment that our sympathy morphs into pity, we're not helping anybody, because that means that we believe in the pitifulness of their circumstance. Oh, you poor, miserable wretch. So two things happen when we get to that place. One is that we are, be like giving somebody a blessing. They're kneeling before you and you put your hands on their head and you say, "Thou art a poor, miserable wretch. I declare this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So it is." The other is that you buy into the whole thing for yourself as a potential, that's a reality, that victimhood is a reality in your life. So self doesn't react, it acts, it responds to the needs of those around us, of all the circumstances around us, and it does it in a mysterious way. Some of the ways that it does are very clear and obvious, make sense, you know, and in other ways, it doesn't, you know. Probably a good object lesson in that is how you feel when you're walking down the street past panhandlers, you know, and what's happening in that moment. It kind of puts the whole thing to a test of reality for you. What is it that's happening? You know, first, are you inclined to cross the street to avoid them? You know, because you don't want to be put on the spot. They're going to ask you for something and gauge you, and you don't want to deal with it. Or do you have a pat answer? You know, or no answer at all. You just like, "I don't see you, I don't hear you, I'm just walking along." You know, or is your pat answer, "I'm sorry, brother, I don't have any money." You know, or "next time, I'll catch you." or do you keep some loose change in your pocket for those circumstances, and just to be able to do something? Everybody gets something, you know. Or is there no pat answer? And that's when it becomes real. Now all of a sudden you're responding from the spirit, right? What does this person need? What in all the cosmic events and energies and things that are going on that are so mysterious, what is happening in this confluence of time and energy in this moment? What is this person really there for? What is really happening on that street corner? And so at the very least, you're finding yourself engaging. You're not walking by anybody. You're making sure that it's a human contact and you're connected. Because without that connection, there's no response. You can't feel that response. So first is, you know, hooking the jumper cables to the battery. I'm here. Now, what's flowing? Okay, so it might be, yeah, I'll take you to the diner, you know, or here's $50, man. Knock yourself out. Or nothing for you today, but God bless you, you know. And if you haven't done some version of those things, then you have that to look forward to, because that's really the kind of thing we're talking about here, you know. And so we hear all the action and reactionary dialogue going on about politics and current events and who said what and blah, blah, blah. And if we can put it into that same framework of meeting this panhandler on the corner, and what's the response? What is self responding to, and in what way? What's the blessing that is happening? Otherwise, we're just doing, it's a whole been there, done that to death kind of thing that has never gotten, it hasn't advanced anything, right? Now, I know that the way that self is responding in me has to do with those first things that I was reading, you know, things that I felt that I stood for. And by that I meant things that I feel this response in me to be kind, compassionate, caring, empathetic, to have dignity for all living things, and so on, you know. But I know people that will have that same list and who are just, it's not alive, right? So that's that. Okay. So we've talked about this before. Lisa, and I know you and I have, about the three gems of Buddhism, taking refuge in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, right? And we can't take refuge in the Sangha, which is our community of fellow disciples, our fellow seekers, devotees. We can't do that if we're not also doing the first two things. Then all we've got is a club. We're not taking refuge in anything. We just joined a club, which may or may not be satisfying for a while. We can't take refuge in Dharma, which is the spiritual transmission or the essence of the teachings, without being connected to the first step, taking refuge in the Buddha, the present Buddha, all past Buddhas, and all future Buddhas, right? Because then we're just on an intellectual exercise. I'm studying the Dharma. I'm memorizing what I need to memorize so that I can, right? We've been there, I've been there. So it all comes back to that first seeking refuge in the Buddha, in the Christ, right? In seeking first the kingdom of God so that these other things can be added to us, right? So if we're doing that, let's just say that that's, we're checking that off our list, yep. Refuge number one, check. Got it. I'm really seeking God in all things, all the time, as the source, of all that is, period. That nothing else is, comes in second to that. That is it. And then I find myself in the flow of consciousness emanating from that, which is the Dharma. That's that. That's what that is. It's the flow of consciousness that emanates from that connection with the divine. And then there's this Sangha business, this business about sharing that with one another, where two or more are gathered in my name, there shall I be in the midst. And that is why it's important in these days, more than any other time maybe, to be able to rub elbows with fellow seekers, with those who are fellow devotees, who have taken these steps to heart. Because we are in the middle of it. We are being bombarded and battered about by all these out of control forces. And it's easy for us to slip out of that place where we are responding to the needs and we become reactionary. Right. But when we're together and we can help that, then it kind of helps us remind one another of what's really important and how to keep that equilibrium. And so that circle that you have, the circle of fellow seekers, fellow walkers of the way, is an important thing to cherish and to encourage, to fan the embers of that. And so it's important to get an understanding, a feeling for who those people are and where they are. Because it's not, again, it's not necessarily the obvious. It's not just those of us in this room. It's not just those of us who are giving lip service to following the way, or who think of themselves as followers of the Christ, or, you know, all of a sudden we're opening ourselves up to something that is way more profound. When Christ said, "Where two or more are gathered in my name," he wasn't talking about people, you know, getting together at Starbucks over a cup of coffee and saying, "And here we are in the name of Jesus Christ, and therefore he is with us." And I know that people think that there are people who think that you, like it's a magic mantra of some kind. If you say these words, then it'll happen. When you pray and say, "In the name of Jesus Christ," then it'll work. But if you don't say those things, it won't work. We've talked, quite a bit over time about what it means to be in the name, what the "in the name of" means. In the presence of is also, that's a synonymous. In the presence of, where two or more are gathered in my presence, there am I. Okay, and we're not, again, talking about the historical Jesus. You know, all of a sudden, sitting there with you. We're talking about the elevation of consciousness that takes place when you have people who are of a like mind and they're striving to know the divine. The rest of it is all the fine print. well, you know, what do you believe about this, and what do you believe about that, and is it Jesus this, or is the Buddha that, is the, what about Zoroaster, what, you know, that's all the fine print, and that has nothing to do with this that I'm talking about. So when we do our egg of light exercise, and we're envisioning the world, and seeing then that the boundaries between countries are fictitious, that they really don't exist, that the idea of universal brother sisterhood is a reality, that we are a single organism on the planet, if not elsewhere as well, and that we are giving our attention and our life to that, and carrying that awareness, that consciousness, into our activities. Okay. Does this make sense, what I'm talking about? Is it helping, or is it just more words? I'm not sure. Is there anything that you can take away from this and say, yeah, this is...
Well, it's what I've been experiencing to be true, or true is hard, right? I don't know what's true, but the way I language is slightly different. You know, I'm seeing that, you know, we can't trust our beliefs, you know, and a lot of what I'm experiencing around me is people reacting to their beliefs, and I have beliefs, they have beliefs, and nobody knows the truth. But what's important, I think, is focusing on what we have in common, this list, whatever that is, the core of our being, that we all share, that unites us as opposed to dividing us. Mm-hmm. We're coming from that place of love and unity and not fear. I don't really know what's happening, and but I feel good. I feel tremendous beauty, and you know, and I see everything around me right now. Everyone's freaking out, and it's just not my experience. So then I say, well, I don't know if it's just because I'm coming from a different belief system, or if it's just, I don't know. It doesn't matter. I feel good about how good I feel, and I want to help people get to that place. Mm. But as they hear me, they project onto what I'm saying as something else. You see?
Yeah, I know that really well. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But that's okay too. That's okay too. But so anyway, to your answer, I think for me it makes sense. And it's not just words. And I feel so much gratitude. Oh, sorry, but I do. I just feel so much gratitude. And, you know, this whole idea, I'm going to go off here a little. I can edit this out, but, you know, I do. I just feel so much gratitude for the Sangha here. You know, I mean, this experience. Yeah, and I just want to say thank you, man. I do. I just want to say thank you for... You feel compelled. You say you can't help it. You have to be here anyway. But, you know... yeah, anyway. So, yeah, no, they're not just words.
Well, just so you know, I'm sure I've said it before, I don't want to ever not say it enough, and that is how important it is for me too, to have this kind of connection. And so it's not a one-way street, believe me. You know, there's a bumper sticker that if you're not outraged, you're not paying attention. You ever see that one or hear that one? You're not outraged, you're not paying attention. And that's kind of the wall that we bump up against in trying to be placeholders for these ideals. And that is that people will tend to look at that as a way of, like you're burying your head in the sand, or you're just trying to shine it on, or it's some of that New Age BS, and you know, this goofy kind of spirituality that doesn't engage the world and you know. And to me, that saying of if you're not outraged, you're not paying attention is really telling, because I'm paying really close attention and I am not outraged on a good day. No. You know, when I'm living this ideal of God is light and in him is no darkness at all. When I'm in touch with that, there's no outrage in that, and there's excruciatingly fine focus on what's happening, penetrating focus on what's happening, right? But everybody will want you to jump into that wagon with them and get outraged.
I think that's the challenge I'm having right now, is I'm so in shock and just amazed by the outrage, like, that I am obsessed by that, and I need to take one more step further, yeah. Right? I mean, this is my opportunity, is to go, you know, I'm just yeah, I'm just beside myself, and I say, God, maybe I'm just not seeing. The analogy that came to me, because I don't know what's true. I don't know what's true. I really don't know what's true. But I remember the first time when I had a sensitivity to Christian teachings, and I would hear someone speak, all I would hear are my reactions. I wasn't even hearing. I wasn't experiencing what was in it. And I don't know what their intention was or wasn't, right? And then when after I had certain experiences where I could go anywhere and all I heard was the love, I just heard love coming out of it. It didn't matter, right? And then people would hear the whatever the, this, you know, you joked about sin not being this or that, but even that, you know, that language, I would hear what sin is for me. I mean, my understanding of it, so even the way it was delivered, everything just came as love to me, you know? And so now, even in this political thing, I'm not hearing things the way other people are hearing them. I don't know if I'm just not hearing. Maybe I'm not paying enough attention to the details. But I'm like trusting, like, the unfolding of this thing is like everything is just in our best interest, like everything. And I don't even know what's real. You know, I don't know what's real, except for an experience. It's the only thing. And aligning with that, and not being so in shock of the reaction that's happening. If that's my work right now, then I gotta take it to another level. because I am just like amazed and caught. I'm just like, wow, wow. But I need to, yeah, again, I need to go deeper here.
Yeah.
But I don't know, man.
No, I've been doing this a number of years, and this is the most trying period that I've found myself, the testing of what I know and all that during this period. It's really interesting, and it's really where the rubber meets the road, you know. It's not enough to be able to shine it on when you're out in the middle of the woods and butterflies and birds are around you, and you know, and but when there are billions of people who are in upheaval in different ways, and that there are some predominant themes to that upheaval, that's powerful. And so that says, okay, where am I in that? You know, if I can wade out to my knees, ripples of the water on the ocean, I'm saying, I'm good. I can maintain my equilibrium here, you know. But when that tsunami wave comes along, what happens, you know? And that means we really need to be well grounded. We have to know and declare in every fiber of our being that God is light and in Him is no darkness at all. And there's only one way that we can get there. It's not through, you know, adopting another belief system. It's going within and going within and letting go to that light that is in us, that is all that is, and letting it just keep transforming and transfusing and permeating and synchronizing every part of us with itself, you know. Every one of us needs to be able to say those words with that much certainty. This we know to be true and declare to you. You know.
When you're in that place and you are making that declaration and someone comes to you and they start going off about the political situation, what do you say from that place?
Yeah, that really depends. It's sort of like the panhandler, right? Walking up, how are you going to respond to the panhandler? So it has been as varied as there have been circumstances, you know, I'm finding how I'm responding to those things. I know what the temptation is, because there's a part of me that wants to just roll up my sleeves and wade in swinging, just like everybody else, you know. I can get there. I have strong feelings about things too, if I let myself play in that sandbox, you know. But there are people that you're talking to who may or may not be able to ever hear anything. There's nothing to say. There's only what you know. Okay, and so the trick is, and this is actually a function of the priesthood, a priestly tool, is that you are taking that and bringing it into the light. You don't have to say anything. Like, I'm sure you do that in therapy sessions, in your way, that you're just inviting what they're releasing or what they want to release and haven't been able to yet. And you're just calling it forth, you know? And where are you calling it forth to? Well, you have to have a place to bring it to, you know?
Yes, I'm seeing. Which is, you know, like I got to today, I was having a conversation with somebody, and I was like, this is so great, because, you know, it's just bringing to the surface, you know, even how people are responding, you know, with so much negativity. I'm like, that's great, because it's coming up. Their own... they don't want to look at their negativity, and they're just projecting it all over, and I think it's so good. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do know what you mean.
It's a purging. Yeah. It's like a purging. The challenge I have is I'm trying to get people to see it, and that's not my job. My job is not make you see how you're being, you know, your negativity is coming forth. I like your suggestion, which is this Tong Len suggestion, right, of transforming, transmuting, bringing it in and just absorbing and transmuting and then coming back out. But but I get caught in this idea that, you know, I look at this, what I see or perceive as hypocrisy, I don't know if I'm seeing it properly, but it's just like, wow, look at all the negativity. And then the teaching of the servant away about being that placeholder for, you know, for, I don't know, the light for the, for,
you know, there's that saying you hear, it's all good, you know. It's all good, man. And it really is all good. And it's another one of those things that if you say it to the wrong person, they're going to bop you over the head because they think that you're, well, they'll invariably play the Hitler card, you know.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. And so if we can understand that all things in our lives, everything that we've ever experienced, good, bad, indifferent, has produced growth. That's what it does. We grow from our experiences. Sometimes we, in hindsight, value more the experiences which were hard and bad at the time, we would have characterized as bad at the time, because they produced the most growth, right? Growth is good. So if all experience produces growth and all growth is good, then ergo, all experience is good, right? And so we take a look at these things without judgment and accept them for what they are, as this cleansing, this upheaval, this intensification, whatever it is that's happening, and let it run its course and not abdicate our responsibility to respond, our response ability, right? In doing that. I know people that will walk away from the whole thing and any of these discussions and say, another day in samsara. It's all an illusion. So it doesn't matter. And that's true. But it does matter, because it also, there are people who are suffering in the midst of things and they need to have a meal, or they need to have a kind word, or they need to have some intervention on their behalf, you know. And that's what responds. That's what we find ourselves in the midst of. This is an interesting tour of duty that we have when we incarnate on Earth. You know, it's not like one size fits all, bam, and out the door you go. It's like, okay. So for 70 years, the Soviet Union clamped down with an iron fist on dissent. Not just dissent against the Soviet Union, but against what had been historically competing and combating tribalism, right? Yugoslavia and, you know, all over the place. It was just, you know, like Pax Romana, right? It was like the Roman peace was enforced, and you will not fight anymore. You will not, you will, if you're not getting along, then damn it, you better pretend like you are, because not getting along is no longer okay. And so that for 70 years that was in. And the rest of Europe, which was also pretty goofy 70 back in those days, had to work it out. They developed their relationships, and they, the old enmities, they developed ways to, you know, get along. England and France, for God's sake, have a long history of battling, you know, conquests and incursions, and they figured it out. You know, there's still whatever undercurrents, but they figured out ways to be civil. But when that Iron Curtain came down, when that wall came down, it was like reversion to 70 years ago. Right? And all of a sudden, all those groups that were there that were forced to get along and forced to experience some civility had to figure it out from scratch, and they just went nuts, right? Terrible wars and genocides, and until they finally came out of it or are coming out of that. That's what happens. That's what's happening in the world today at large. Is that we've had this kind of synthetic expectation. It's an implementation of a kind of morality, of social behavior that comes from the outside rather than from the inside. And so when you're given permission to act in goofy ways, in terrible ways, what you carry with you in your heart is all that is going to be, that's your moral compass, right? And so the book, The Heart of Darkness, or the movie that was spun off from that about the Apocalypse Now, is a story about just that thing. How will you act if all the moral strictures that govern your behavior are removed? If nobody, you could do anything, you had a carte blanche to do anything, behave in any way, how would you behave? No repercussions, nobody's going to look, nobody's going to do anything. Go. How are you going to behave? And that's what's happening right now, is that those external moral strictures are being cast off, and people are just coming out of the woodwork in all sorts of ways. And I'm not just talking about Trump supporters or the right wing. I'm talking about, you know, people that are saying peace and love and then acting in a bit terrible ways, you know. As long as it's an external force that is governing our behavior, then we are going to be trapped. So yes, it's a wonderful thing in my mind that it's happening. You know, okay.
Well, it's a wonderful thing personally.
Yeah.
Because it's ultimately about our choosing to grow. and be in that. I mean, if we look at it, you know, this is where I keep coming back to, is that there's all that out there that may not even be out there. I don't know the nature of reality. But what I do know is how I'm responding.
Right.
That's the only choice I ever get on my journey. And it's how you started this tonight with that prayer, and start each one about elevating our consciousness. From a Buddhist perspective, it's raising from the animal nature,
mm-hmm.
and saying I'm more than the DNA code that is pushing. I have a choice to create space so that more spirit can inhabit and my consciousness can be raised.
You know, when we ordain a priest, part of that built right into the ceremony is that they have to vow and acknowledge that they will always honor the free will of the people that they're working with, that they will not tamper with that. For this very reason, there cannot be an external constraint. It has to come from within us, otherwise it's just a time bomb ticking away, right? Okay, let's close. O great being in whom we do live and do move and do have our very being, we are filled with gratitude for the way that has been given to us to follow. May we be blessed in every way possible, that we can follow that way as we seek enlightenment for the liberation of all sentient beings. In the name and presence of Christ Jesus and of our Mother Mary. Amen.